It is another gorgeous day on planet Earth and another day of a dose of Did You Know, where intriguing, inspiring, unique individuals come to talk love and life and how it got them to here today. Did I tell you that's what we're going to talk about, David?
You
I didn't
did.
Tell him anything.
No, I don't know anything.
No, he knows nothing, but he is here. No, this is my very good friend, all the way from his studio in Arizona, which I will be seeing you shortly. I'm super excited about our trip. Or my trip there, where
Can't
I
wait.
Get to harass you a little bit.
Round two.
Round two, but no margaritas this time for me.
Oh, really? Oh, yeah, that's right. I'll have enough for both of us then.
Yes, I'm going to have like the virgin ones. You're going to have the real deal because I'm getting this brain therapy. And apparently alcohol doesn't mesh when you have brain therapy rebalancing.
I heard those rumors. Yeah, I don't know. Rumors. It might be true, though.
I'll let you know how it goes. But before we get started, David, tell the world a little bit about who you are.
A little bit about who I am. I'll say something that a lot of people may not know. I don't say this a lot. I was born in Saudi Arabia. Mm. I lived there for about a total of 10 years. I lived there when I was born to when I was 5, and then again, age 10 to 15-ish.
Like big parts of your life. That's not like I was born, came back here. That's
right.
Like your brain is developed from 0 to 5, and then you're kind of a teenager.
I don't think my brain has yet to develop, but thank you. Yes, those were four.
I give you credit. I give you credit for what's there.
Those were formative years. I went to the Saudi Arabian International School American section. So, you know, American teachers, American curriculum. There's a huge American school system internationally. My parents were working over there, but that's something a lot of people don't know about me. But I grew up speaking, reading, writing Arabic, which helped later on in my military life. I did spend 6 years, 6 and a bit in the Army, played that game for a while, did great things, got out of the Army in 2006 or 7, and then just been on a roller coaster ride ever since. The past 5 years have been looking up, so that's good, but it was a roller coaster ride for a while. But it's been fun.
You're steady now. We're going to go with your steady. The roller coaster
like
is over, right?
Yes, roller coaster.
Little excitement,
over.
A steady excitement.
Yeah, excitement's one word to describe it.
Yeah, I want to go back because I know we've had this conversation, but it's a fascinating conversation for me. Is like, what is it like to grow up there? I mean, talk to me about that.
In Saudi Arabia?
Yes.
I absolutely loved it, to be honest. It was, and this is pre-9/11. So again, this is the 90s after the first Gulf War. So my second time, so the first time there obviously was 80s. I was born in 82. So 82 to 87. And I was in a very small city. I mean, picture like the most, you know, redneck town in America, that version in Saudi Arabia. There was an Air Force base there. My father was there for his job at the time. So a very small city. And then the second time in Saudi Arabia, I was in the capital in Riyadh. Absolutely loved it. Big shout out to the Riyadh crew if they're listening. They're big on Facebook. Big shout out to my Arabic teacher. She's always on Facebook as well. Love her. But great people, great times. Yeah, it was good years.
So is like dating the same?
Oh, yeah. Well, we lived on an American compound. I mean, you can't date outside. I mean, it's
right.
and especially back then, it was very, you know, even restaurants have a male only section and then a family section. Women couldn't drive at the time. I think now, just in the past couple of years, women can drive now in Saudi Arabia. But yeah, that's very, you know, closed, if you will.
Did any of that kind of mindset translate when you came back? I don't know. You think that separation, you live it for so long, it becomes normal?
No, because we lived in an American compound. So, I mean, there's like, you know, 1,000, 1,500 houses on this compound of all Americans. But you get an international taste of the world. I mean, when you live in a foreign country, you know, you just get a greater understanding of the international community and the world and as a whole. So that is instilled in me from day one.
Okay, so ladies, he's not gonna make you, you know,
walk
behind him
no.
and clean his shoes. Just no. clarifying that because you have a big fan base out there of women.
I'll
You're a bachelor.
I'll walk behind you guys. I'm in the back. I'm in the shadows.
But I do have to tell you, so Heather and Angelo are watching, and you, so I don't know how you ended up at the tattoo party that's going to be happening.
Oh, I'm going to fly in for it. I'm excited for this.
But, and Heather's going to hold Angelo's hand. You need a hand. Angelo doesn't have tattoos.
He doesn't?
Nope.
I got four, so I'll take a fifth.
I think he's the only Marine out there without a tattoo on his body. At least that I know. Oh, I do know some others. Well, you're not a rarity, Angelo.
His creativity makes up for it. I love his content and his pictures and everything they're doing out there in Florida.
Oh my God, they're very good. Lori, yes, there's a tattoo party. It will be filmed. It is going to be a show in itself. So don't worry, you'll see it. I just don't know when yet, but it's happening.
I need 48 hours notice.
48 hours. Okay. It's actually when the IW Fort Lauderdale hike is going to happen.
I just signed up for my first IW hike in Tucson on October 24th. I even have it written on a note card. IW hike, Tucson. You can't see that. There you go.
Oh.
Yeah, I got my order number and everything. So can't wait.
Shoot, I bet you Heather's going to be there.
She is. Yeah, we chatted this morning. She's gonna try to make it.
Okay, the jealousy is rising inside Danny because I am not going to be there. I'm going to be in Florida when you guys are in Tucson. Sugar.
We'll figure it out. There's one. We'll all make it one of these days.
It'll happen. But moving forward, so yes. You've got some cool new, I mean, I guess it's not new because it's season two, but season two is kind of new. I'm going to still call it new. I'm going to still call it a new thing. The David Johnson Show. What in the heck is it all about your life and your love? You're going to like devolve some like deep, dark secrets?
The David Johnson Show has nothing to do with me. I'm still halfway embarrassed. My name's all over it. But the David Johnson Show has three aspects to it. First and foremost, this started as a talk show. In season one, we filmed 10 episodes. And what a lot of people don't know about that as well is we filmed 10 episodes in 48 hours. That was grueling. And let me tell you this.
Why would you do that? I mean, I guess logistics and tech, all of that stuff, but jeebus, how did you not, what were you taking? Like what energy drink did you drink or coffee?
Well, listen, I was on everything and nothing at the same time. Adrenaline kept me going. It was awesome. And 45 days prior to our filming, this didn't even exist. Like it was literally not even an idea. This went from idea to execution to film to launching the first video in almost 45 days to 60 days. 10 guests flew in from all over the country, East Coast, California, literally everywhere, came in Sunday night at 7:30 to a Tuesday night at 7:30. We filmed 10 episodes. And conclusion to that story, the Tuesday that we stopped filming, that was St. Patty's Day, and that was the day the governor of Arizona put Arizona in lockdown. Like we were going to leave the studio, go have this massive dinner and drinks and celebrate, and we leave the studio, and it's like, well, Phoenix is in lockdown.
So what did you do? All crash back at your place?
We did. We came back to my place.
How you roll.
I got pizza and beer and just kind of had a little shindig. It was very small, but... it was good. And then that was that.
Oh, okay. Look, I'm going to come back to this, but this tattoo party is getting really big. Uh-oh. Jason's on board now. I'm just seeing this.
Where's Jason?
Sheehan?
Oh, Jay? Yeah.
Jay. He's your man. Cause I can tell his little picture that comes up is from your studio.
I will have to hold Jay's hand.
Come on. He said he said a new tattoo. So he has them. So are you saying that someone held his hand on the ones before?
I wasn't there, but I will place everything on it that somebody had to hold his hand.
Are we going to have a support team during this? The people actually doing it, because we will be having a conversation. So this is going to be like, how tough are you? Can you go under the needle? I can't say that. Under the needle and still have a show.
Yes, I think so. And Angelo's tattoo, I want to see on his rib cage.
That's where mine are both. And that's a hard one, Angelo. Don't take that bet. Don't go there. Do it like on your bum or something. Somewhere nice and soft.
That's funny.
Okay, so you did this. You have this big party afterwards. And then, okay, why? How did it come so fast?
Like
the idea to the filming.
So, you know, we rented out, season two is going to be a lot different, and I'll touch on that in a second, but season one was, you know, there's three studios, major kind of studios here in town in Phoenix, and there's many different avenues you could go. You could just rent out the studio and then supply your own production team and everything like that, or you could rent the studio with the production team, so on and so forth. So there's a lot of different avenues. So I just rented out the studio. And then we set up the studio ourselves, and we had to get the biggest bang for our buck. So, you know, initially it was going to be a half an hour to 45 minute just talks. And I'm like, okay, well, I could do three of those in a day. You know, and people are flying in, you have to coordinate everything. And you couldn't do it over a span of a month. It just didn't make sense financially, logistically. Furthermore, you know, looking back, hindsight's always 20/20. Thank God we didn't, because we went into COVID. And then everything was locked down. Even if this project was pushed back a week, which we were thinking to do that to give us more time, we would have gone into COVID, lockdown, this whole thing would have been squashed.
Right. Done. See, perfectly placed there. I am so like, all right, so we know I always like lead with love and all of this stuff, right? That's like my thing. And
I love it.
And I believe everything is perfectly placed. There are no mistakes. And Jason, if I had a call-in number to get him straight, I wouldn't. The phone would ring off the hook, because I think everybody would call it, be calling in for David, with all of his bull crap that he tells. Understand? But what a blessing. Okay, back on track. Blessing about everything being perfectly placed in your life at that exact time, because that was like 45 days from your thought to filming, and then a shutdown of the world happening, and now the reopening, because Arizona is just kind of, I feel like it's newly reopening.
It's newly reopening. Yeah. I mean, it's getting more and more, obviously still all the social distancing, but it's starting to open, and it's starting to open even, you know, we got the studio, and we're doing a different studio this time, on track for season two. So I actually just finalized that yesterday. The COVID and the timing. And then, candidly, during the quarantine from March 17th, at least in Phoenix, it lasted 60 days or whatever it did, it actually was somewhat, I tried to turn it into a blessing in disguise, because then I was home all day, so I could work. I could focus on the show and really try to figure out, okay, what's the next step? What's going on here? Whereas opposed, if it was business as usual, it'd have been hard, because, you know, this is still a passion project for me. I run my day-to-day company full time. You know, there are weeks I'll go 2-3 days without even touching anything on the show, because I'm so busy, you know, doing other things. And then so, but it all kind of just worked out.
It did just work out. But why? Okay, so why do the show to begin with? What even made you want to do this? I mean, because you're busy, you have a company, you run a company, a very successful company that you've built, and you should be very proud of.
I'm very proud. Like, thank you.
That's what you're supposed to tell me what you do, because that's my like.
Oh, was that was the hint to tell you what I do?
Yeah.
Was that? Oh, okay. That was the hint. Oh, I got it. Okay. Yeah, sorry, I'm a little bit slow this morning. It's very boring. I'm in the employee benefit industry. So I go into companies and I structure their benefits. In 20 seconds, most Americans get their health insurance from a company. Behind the scenes on all of that is a me of the world. I'm a very small player in the game. But nonetheless, there's an employee benefit broker that has to structure the deal financially, make sure all the right hospital and doctor networks are in, and yada, yada, yada. It's very boring stuff.
It is very boring. And you have such like a bubbly, outgoing personality.
Well, for the record, employee benefit as an industry is a phenomenal industry. I mean, most
are you
people
telling me it's sexy and exciting, because I don't really agree with you.
No, but you could work 3 days a week and make some recurring revenue. And what's wrong with that?
Okay, well, that's sexy and exciting.
Yeah.
All right.
And then it allows me the time freedom and the financial freedom to be a wannabe talk show host and start the David Johnson Show, because, back to your other question, I see how you did that. I've always been passionate for veterans, always, since the day I got out of the military, always, 100% always. And our stories need to be told, and they need to be told in a way that I hope they catch on a national level. And the only way we had any hope in hell to catch on any sort of grand scale is to bring that level of production quality along then with the guests and the content. So I'm really hoping that this turns into a platform just to get messages out, to tell the stories of our people, for us, for our fellow Americans, for our kids, for my 7-year-old who's going to watch these maybe in 5, 10, 20 years, whatever have you. We just need that national platform.
So, like, I remember Heather, our great friend Heather, she talking one time, or it might have been on one of her posts about it, when I first started, like, watching you and figuring out who you were. I don't even know how that even happened, but somehow you ended up in my world. No mistakes, right? No mistakes. But she said she would like listen and have like a notebook because there was so much value that what is given during the show. So I feel like that's a little bit more than just telling your story.
You know, that kind of just happened by, I'm not going to say happenstance, that was a goal, but I've heard that, and I'm honored to hear that. I mean, it is like fuel to keep me going, because candidly, this shit is hard. It is not easy. It's damn expensive, and it's grueling. And yeah, to hear people who watch Keith Carraway's video, to watch Jay Sheehan's video, to watch Matt's video on digital marketing and the entrepreneurship video, and to hear people say that it's making an impact on their life, it's amazing.
Well, I think that's kind of what, for me, that's about. You want to go out with value, right? So everybody has a great story, but what are you going to learn from it? What are they doing now? What tools and skills can they share that is going to help somebody else in marketing, in entrepreneurship, in all of those things? That, to me, gives a little bit more like spunk or something. Maybe spunk isn't the word, but.
Hey, I'm with you. Spunk is, we're there. We're on the right track.
We're on it. We're rolling it. Now, but you have, times are running out and I have all these things I want to talk about, but you're also expanding that. Can I even say that? Is that a secret? I mean, I know I got an email. I know we've talked about it, but is that like a hidden secret about the expansion?
Listen, we're trying to. So in 30 seconds, that wasn't planned either. We had 10 episodes, like I mentioned in season one. We released 5 of them, and we were still middle COVID. And I'm thinking to myself, you know, we're kind of screwed here because we're going to run out of content. I only have 5 videos left. The world is not open. How do I film more episodes? How do I fly people in? What do I do? So I started thinking, all right, we need other avenues of content. So we now, if you go to our website, thedavidjohnsonshow.com, please subscribe. Thank you very much. Get on our community. Then we have 3 forms of content at the top. We have video, which is our YouTube channel. We have audio, which is going to be our podcast, which is launching in about 2 weeks. A very unique podcast, by the way.
Is that all you're going to say? Very unique podcast? Yeah. That's all I get?
In 30 days, let's come back and let me announce it. It's going to be big.
Okay.
It's going to be big, I think. And then we have the written. We have a blog. We have, you know, obviously the written form. And on the blog, we're going to have guest authors. And we have an author page. And then their blog is going to be syndicated to a viewership of 1 million people. We're on a syndication engine. So video, where's my hand? Oh, I'm going the wrong way. We have video, we have audio, and we have written. Those 3 forms of content we're going to create and distribute.
I hear that you have like one of the hottest, you know, people that talk, you know, love and relationships, that is going to be a blogger there.
She's going to be an author. She is going to be an author. And I've read some of her blogs, by the way, and she is absolutely amazing. The content and the value she's going to bring to our community is going to take everybody, just knock them off their feet.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm in. I'm totally have already subscribed.
Well, thank you. You're amazing. This is, it's all coming together.
I love. So what drives you every day to do this? I mean, because you are a single father. If you follow him for about 2 hot seconds, and you'll know that you are with your son all the time, or he is with you rather, all the time. You run this career and you have this passion project. So what keeps David Johnson going?
Well, right now it's the passion for this project. I'm all in. I love it. I love doing this. And
is it fun learning and connecting with people? Is that what it is? Because I love, like, that's one of the things that I love about this. I love connecting and talking to people and finding out what in their heart makes them tick. Like, that fires me up.
I love connecting with people. I love hearing people's stories, talking to people, connecting, trying to figure all this out. It's like puzzle pieces you got to put together. All of it it fires me up every day.
It's very, very cool. Do you kind of feel like when you connect, this is when you connect with people, and I do it at like this, like love level, because I think if you can actually we've had this conversation before, like everyone has it in us. We have just been, you know, blinded, or we follow these like fake rules of society of what we've learned, and we're not. But it's all connecting and making relationships with people. Don't you find it, or maybe not, because you could be, you know, holding on, and we might need to have like a, you know, a therapy session. I don't know what. But don't you find that it brings like what you can see and the truth of what you can see and feel clearer? Because you're meeting so many people and seeing how the world kind of ticks in all these different ways?
I think the answer is yes. And what you mean by love, I try just to provide value everywhere I go. I don't know if that's the same thing. I don't even know if I'm answering a question or what I'm even talking about right now, but I just try to provide value in everybody that I deal with.
I think value is love. That's
value,
like a form
is
of
love.
Like anything of a positive impact is some form of love.
That should be one of your blogs.
That should.
That statement right there.
I'm gonna have to rewind. I'll rewind.
Okay, good.
But David, before I let you go, and then I get to harass you in perfect, not this Monday, but next Monday. I said imperfect.
Yeah.
In person.
I knew what you meant.
You got it. You right. We're on the same wavelength. What,
yes,
in this moment right now, what does love mean to you, David Johnson?
Love is a desire to do good. When you have a desire to do good to others, not because you have to or you want something in return, you have a true desire to make somebody's life a better person. I just did that. When you want to make their life better.
Yeah.
That's love.
Love it. That sums you up in a nice little nutshell. And my tongue twisting went to you. It's perfect. Perfectly matched. Perfectly placed. It's all good.
Love it.
All good. For everybody out there watching, we will definitely let you know when our tattoo party/show is happening. Maybe there will be bids to go to like their Reverend Warriors hike. We could do like this fundraiser. And you can bid on the person that you think will either not be able to hold a straight conversation during the podcast show, or is going to be the tough. I know. I think there's going to have to be some stakes involved around this.
Stakes as in eating steaks, or stakes as in we're playing for high stakes, or all
the above? I'm thinking both. I mean, I think
okay,
you have to refuel.
Yes.
Because there'll be blood loss and energy loss. We have to refuel on that. And then at
yes.
the same time, we need to do a little good for the hike over there.
We got to show some love.
Yes. See, comes in all kinds of form. Everybody, as always, remember to love hard, love pure, and love proactive. Until next time, we will see you later. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Huh?